And we're back here on the Stogie Geeks Show. Wanted to remind everyone to visit our website, www.stogiegeeks.com. Visit the Stogies feed, which is where we're storing all of our Stogies that we talk about on the show, great, along with ratings. So you'll be able to very easily see on the right-hand side of the page, click a link and see all the Oasis sticks. And that seems to be what people want when they visit the sites, right? Like any stick we review, unfortunately now it's in a separate category, but there's categories for sticks we review on the website, category in a separate section for ones we review on the show that you can click on and sort by our ratings. And that's what people care about. We find that we've got Google Analytics. We can see what people click on. Most people are clicking on the highest rated sticks.
And Paul, explain to the listeners on the new rating that you and Tim have put together.
Yeah, so it's a 2.5. So it's a try one. So it's in between one that is lawn mulch, which you would throw in front of the lawnmower, and it's the other one is.
I love it.
Is it
a great
fiver?
No,
the angler. The angler. Yeah, the angler, which is you'd smoke while fishing
or I like that
mowing the grass. Yeah, so then there's like a try one.
Yep. Tim, you with us?
Oh, wait.
No.
Hang on. Yeah, hang on. As you kill the music, we'll bring Tim back up.
Can you hear us now,
Tim?
How about now?
Yeah, there we go. We're just talking about
our new rating. I had no audio whatsoever while we were on the break, and neither did Ustream, by the way.
Oh yeah. I muted stuff.
Yeah, so. Anyways, the 2.5 is actually between the angler and the fiver.
That makes more sense than lawn mulch. I'm sorry. That's what happens when you have more than one glass of cigar.
Wow!
That's also what happens when you have more than one glass of alcohol.
Remember, we have limousines outside,
you know,
taking us home. You believe that? We wouldn't be in this studio.
Just sit there and drink your cigar and smoke your beer, okay?
Fast moving. I thought you told me you were setting them loose on your neighborhood again.
That's it.
I miss all the good stuff.
And don't trip on any damn rocks when you leave the studio. And you know puking over there, Ben.
Asshole.
Well, he didn't puke in your yacht. It's all good, man.
He did in mine, though.
In the campfire.
I have a very sensitive stomach.
You puked in the campfire, man?
Alrighty. Okay. Let's move on to cigar sizes. This is an introductory segment where I wanted to cover the standard, somewhat more popular, like ones where most of the time when someone's releasing a new line, they will release these sizes. They're the most readily available. I got a lot of my information on. I wanted to go to a place that defines the standard, tobacconistuniversity.org, where you can become a certified tobacconist. So I looked in their glossary. Tim, you also sent me a PDF from them as well. I hope to get that in the show notes.
Okay.
In addition to my link, because it was a good reference. Because sizes are very confusing.
Correct. And there's two levels of sizings.
So explain to us.
Would you say two standards?
Two standards, right. Which I can't pronounce either one because I'm not good at Spanish. But one is odd shapes and a standard shape. One.
Oh, it's a parejo?
Parejo and...
what do they call the other? Figurado?
No. Fagato, which means irregular shape.
I gotcha.
See, I was thinking more you were talking about traditional Cuban vitolas versus the American market standard.
Which is totally different.
Yep. Okay. So we are talking about the American market, correct, Paul?
That's what I'm...
I would say it's the American... I mean, a lot of these are... I would say almost all of these sizes, probably aside from a 6x60, you will find typically in Cuban blends.
Which, although they're starting,
they
to look
are
at
starting
that.
To come into with larger.
Because exactly, American market is buying the Cubans.
Right.
Uh oh.
Wait. Who said that?
Who said that? Okay.
Wait. We were just smoking Cubans. Wait. We still are.
Oh, that's right. It's illegal. Isn't
they get so pissed off when you light them on fire. It's terrible. No.
Oh well. Thanks,
the
John Kennedy.
Stogie Sanders does not represent the Stogie Geeks.
We were burning. what's the word?
What are you drinking now, huh? You got Sandy's
Scotch, of course.
Yeah, listen to us as we get longer in the show.
My Fuente Hemingway bestseller is really good.
Look at the ash.
Not as good as a short story. The burning, drawn construction are awesome. It's box worthy. It's not quite Oasis.
And that's why I think one of my favorite descriptions of a cigar name, I love it, short story. It's just what it is. Isn't it? Think about all the different, you know, Pete Johnson's acclamations of different things, the Cuban cigars, and Illusion has a story. Illusione, right? And Timmy was right. Anyway, everyone has their own little story behind it. I think short story, if you're the name of cigar, that hits it right on, that's it. So anyway, let's get to our...
It's kind of flattening out a little bit as it moves through. Not as much dynamic flavor. Yeah. I find it to be getting a little one-dimensional.
As much as the short story hits the tail, it hits it out of the park.
It hits my sweet spot.
The classic does not.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, think about that.
Now, hold on. So
jumbo shrimp, you know what I mean?
The classic goes short story, work of art, bestseller. Signature then classic or classic then signature?
I thought there was a masterpiece in there, wasn't there?
Well, that's after.
That's after. That's huge. Yeah.
That's
masterpiece is the largest size.
Masterpiece.
Untold story is next size down.
I think it's a signature then classic, right?
I think so.
Yeah. Well, what do we know?
We can figure this out pretty quickly.
Yeah. Right. So the signature.
We just made it up, so let's stick with it.
The signature and classics are kind of.
I think the classic's a little smaller.
They're just
the
okay.
Yeah.
They're just okay.
Yeah.
They don't stand out. I mean, no. And I've smoked all the Maduros and they don't stand out.
Once you go into a Maduro and a Hemingway, there's no going back.
Yeah.
Do you agree with that?
Mm. I agree.
Yes, but the Sun Grown.
Oh, well,
those were phenomenal.
Totally different. They're totally a different animal.
Now, speaking of sizes, to kind of bring it back into our segment, I know we segued a little bit, but that's okay because the sizes that we're talking about in the Hemingway size are very unique. I mean, the size and shape of those cigars does not match what we're going to talk about in this segment.
Because it's so arbitrary. And I mean, again, everyone... Hey, it's going to be confusing. It really is.
It's confusing.
It's a confusing state of let's get back. Let's get to the
segment. So the goal of this segment was to talk about standard sizes,
Excuse me, Paul. What was that, Tim?
Go ahead, Tim.
I was saying, do you want me to read off the sizes of the Hemingway?
Yeah, I just looked it up as well. So, shoot. Yeah,
short story, Between the Lines, bestseller.
Between the Lines, if I got.
Signature, then classic, then Untold Story, and last, the masterpiece.
Right. Thanks, Ted.
Anyway, I digress.
So we're going to talk about standard sizes. There's a lot of weird and wacky sizes, some only which are made by like one manufacturer, and we're going to cover those in future segments. But I wanted to cover the basics, the ones you most often find, primarily, I would say, in non-Cuban cigars, though, again, there is a lot of overlap. So I also want to cover which sizes do you buy when you want to try a blend and which size would you smoke at a certain time. And also talk about somewhat length of time it takes to smoke these.
Right.
And those can all factor into... I mean, I think that the overarching goal and mission of Stogie Geeks is to tell you what you might want to buy, to give you guidance as to which cigars you want to smoke.
To educate.
Yeah, to educate. And in this segment, especially speaks to that.
Except in pronunciation.
Yeah, pronunciation, don't listen to it.
It's okay. It doesn't matter. We mean well. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Here we go.
There's certain smokes you would smoke on certain occasions.
Absolutely.
Smoke them all.
Smoke. So let's start with the smallest size on our list, and this is the Corona.
Mm-hmm.
Now, of course, there is a Petite Corona, but
what's this?
You most often find the Corona, I think, and it's a more standard size. It's typically a 5.25x44 ring gauge.
This is correct.
Okay.
This is correct. Same as almost like the Bellicoso.
But now someone will come up with a 6x43 or a 5.
Right. Let's keep it general.
Yeah.
I think the general terms actually refer more to the ring gauge than they do the actual length of the cigar. Because, you know, you'll have the Robusto, but then you'll have the short Robusto. You know, you'll have the Corona, you'll have the double Corona. I think the ring gauge is more important when you look at those types of names.
And to bring into it, just in case, I'm sure everybody out there knows this. When we're talking ring gauge, we go in the 64th of an inch. That's how each dimension goes.
Right.
Okay.
So I find that this is the Corona is the one that you would want to use to sample a blend, right? Now, I'm told, is the Corona size the one they roll to actually do the blend sampling most often?
More than not.
Yeah, okay. I got you. It's more the standard size.
Right.
I'd say it's around, is it an hour smoking time? 45 minutes to an hour?
See,
it depends on the burn.
Right. You get a cigar smoker who is smoking for the ambiance. Yes. You watch someone who smokes a cigarette, not all the time, but majority of the time, a cigarette smoker whiffs down a cigar. They do. They just suck it down. I would say what you're talking about, you're talking, I would say 45 minutes to an hour. Would you agree with that?
Mm. I would, yeah.
45 minutes
Jim,
to an hour for a
Corona. Do you agree with that?
Absolutely.
Okay.
I agree.
I smoke a ton of Coronas, and a lot of times it's because it's, I'm smoking them at lunchtime.
Right. Exactly. It's a perfect
size. You know, in the Corona, the strength, the flavor, rather, is really concentrated, I find.
Mm-hmm.
Wrapper to filler ratio is, you know.
There you go.
It's an excellent point.
Right.
The ratio of wrapper, how much wrapper leaf there is to filler and binder leaf.
And keep in mind what happens, too, get back, and I don't want to waste too much time on this, is the wrap. This is why it was so difficult, because with larger ring cigars, you can play with more flavor profile. Where with a Corona, you can't, or I'll even say a thinner ring cigar is a little bit more difficult. So keep that in mind. So go ahead, Paul.
So does that round out the Corona for everyone? I think it's a standard size. In almost any blend, you're okay with a Corona. I think it represents the blend very well in pretty much any blend.
Cigar geeks.
And a lot of people make Coronas well.
Right.
I think it's one of two Vitolas that when you smoke them, it's a connoisseur's size, the Corona.
Yeah. I wish it would gain more popularity, because I think people would get a better flavor experience.
That's my job at the store, and I find it you hit it, then you hit the nail right on the head. It really is becoming slowly, but still going slowly, it's coming around.
In price point now, to factor that in, it's typically the least expensive of most of the lines,
right,
in being the smaller size.
Mm-hmm.
And you can get an hour out of that smoke.
Right.
You know?
Think about it. And that's gonna like Tim was saying, he's at work and everybody else is out there. It gives you all that what you need.
Mm. I'm going to round off the Corona with one statement from Dion of Illusion A Cigars.
Oh,
he calls the MK, which is his Corona, the teaching machine.
Right.
Yeah. And I think that says a lot about Vitola, in general speaking.
Right, and speaking of the MK, we'll do that in another story. But anyway, let's stick with this.
Robusto is the next one on the list, the next size up. That's typically a 5x50.
5x50, 5x52.
And now, again, the sizes are going to vary, but most typically it's close to...
Right.
I mean, you're going to see 5.5 by 51.
Just keep it general.
5x50 ring gauge. Also best for sampling the blend, I think. Probably my second choice for sampling the blend.
By far.
This is the second cigar I was mentioning of the two.
Now, your smoking time is more like an hour for Robusto.
Solid.
You shouldn't be sucking down a Robusto in 45 minutes flat, right?
Like, you know what's going to happen? You're going to change the flavor of the cigar.
Yeah, you're going to burn it too hot.
Yeah, exactly.
So I'd say an hour to an hour and 15, or an hour, would you?
1 hour. 1 hour is a minimum. How's that?
Minimum.
If it takes
you an hour and a half.
That's fine. But if you're sucking that down in 30 minutes or 45 minutes, you're changing that flavor.
Yeah. So it's a longer smoke than I think people think, because the length is so short. It's sometimes even shorter than a Corona, but a little larger ring gauge.
By far.
I think it's a very satisfying size. Where you can get a real feel for what the blend is, but still feel satisfied at the end.
I think that's a great way to describe that, actually.
Now, there are some people that only smoke Robustos.
My humidor is a full half with Robustos. I mean, literally, half the cigars in my humidor are
Robustos. Well, it fits your smoking time, right?
Right. Yeah, you're a busy guy, Tim, so you got to fulfill what you need.
I think a lot of the need to have cigars that's come out in the last 2 years have been Robustos or short Robustos. Like, you think of some of the cigars that you needed to have, I think more so than not, the Robusto size is on that list.
Mm. Okay.
I agree. So Robusto is a very standard. I mean, you'll probably find in most of the lines that are released, you're going to find something pretty close to a Robusto.
Right.
You're going to find something pretty similar to that 5x50 size in almost any line that's released.
Yep, right. And especially, a Robusto comes in big, especially in the Northeast, is weather. I mean, it really changes what smoke in the New England area.
Yeah, when it's cold out.
When it's cold out, you're out in that garage, studio B, or wherever it happened to be, that has a lot to do with it, too.
Yeah,
so anyway.
I agree. The next up on the list is a Toro, and Tim, did you happen to fill in what the Toro and the Churchill were, or?
No, but I do have the information.
Yes, thank you.
Generally speaking, a Toro is a 6x50. It's an inch longer than a Robusto.
Right.
That's a good deal.
It's one I go to on a Friday and Saturday night when I have a little bit more time, and I want to spend a little bit more time enjoying that favorite, stick of mine. It would definitely tack on a good 15 to 20 minutes to the smoking time.
You think Toro's like hour and a half?
Yes, maybe just short of an hour and a half.
But for me, that's about what.
And you say an inch, but it makes a difference.
Absolutely,
it does.
Yeah.
No, it's not almost. You won't always find a Toro size in every blend.
I think the three in New England area. I can't stress that enough. I would say the four major categories in New England. It's going to be your Robusto, Toro, Churchill, and we'll allude to this later on, is a 6x60. Yeah. That's going to be the four blends. Anyway, go ahead.
Well, speaking of Churchill, that's next on the list, right, Paul? Yeah.
That would be a 7x49.
Yes.
Is that 48, correct?
Yeah, exactly. 46 to 48.
Gotcha.
I think go ahead, Tim.
I was just going to say, Tobacco University does list it as a 7x48.
Yeah. Right.
Exactly. 48, okay.
48, right. It goes to 46 to 48. You go any lower, you're going into a Lonsdale size.
I think this is that size of cigar is a cigar that you smoke with people who, you know, you know cigars as much as you do, and you're out having a nice time, and you have enough time to smoke that long of a cigar that, you know, it creates a lot of smoke, and it is a lot longer to smoke that cigar than, you know, your typical Toro or your Robusto.
I know you're going to go.
So, yeah, okay.
I also feel like a Churchill is what a lot of people will reach for when they're first starting to smoke cigars. At least I did. And I've talked to many people that have had the same experience. You feel like you're getting more cigar for the money.
Right.
Yep. It's a bigger, longer cigar than a Robusto or a Corona for sure.
Right.
And maybe it's not quite as daunting as a 6x60 to some people. Mm-hmm. So they go for the Churchill, right?
And you look at any Churchill blend, almost, I'm not going to say all. I don't want to broad stroke it with one brush. But isn't it amazing with a Churchill, the best part of it turns into the Robusto, if that makes sense. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, I agree.
The first third is like, okay, then all of a sudden it kicks in. And once you start smoking cigars, you find that out. I'm not saying the Churchill's a bad size. I'm not saying that. But you feel once you get into that Robusto size, that's when all the flavor comes in. Okay, here we go.
I just finished my Fuente bestseller, and I reached into my humidor to pull out another cigar. And when I pulled it out and Mark Jr. saw what it was, he lifted a finger towards me.
So there's two things. Oh, no, think about it, listeners out there. See, Mr. Azadorian is a opus whore. And number two, he is a talent, Paul.
I'm a Davidoff whore.
So he's a whore in two ways.
That's right. Some would say more than two. But.
Yeah, but whatever.
Yeah, so this is a Davidoff Colorado Claro, the short Perfecto.
Right. And just showing, see, with the Perfecto, what happens, right, what you have is a closed foot, and that makes the difference.
Can I just give everybody a little hint out there? These would just be released and are available on the web as of today.
Yes.
Yeah, this one's from
Cigarin, right?
This one's from 2008.
We don't really need to tell anyone about that. Okay, so just take it easy.
They're sold out. They're sold out, is what Tim was saying.
Yes, they're all done.
They're already sold out.
Yeah, Mark, they're either at Mark's house, Stogie's, or Mark, Paul, Tim, and
Mark,
Ben.
Mark, if you want to know where to find them, just drop me a line.
I know where to find them.
All right.
All right, let's go. We did the Churchill. Now, this is... It's funny. I'm talking to different salesmen, and it just seems like this cigar is the most popular size, and there's nothing wrong with that. But the 6x60 bomber,
Gigante.
We can jump to that. I mean, the name.
We just did the Churchill.
Yeah. Well, I had a couple
Gigante,
before that.
Gigante 6x60.
We skipped a couple, but that's all right. We'll go back.
No. We'll go. Yeah, the 6x60. I mean, the name says it all, right? Yep. 6 inches long by 60 ring.
Right.
And as we've said before on the show. When you get something in a 60 ring, you're tasting a lot more of that filler than you are the, I think, both binder and wrapper, I would say.
I think in my 6x60, the experience is that's for people who smoke cigars that don't want that strong cigar. Because what it does with the binder and filler, not that it's any less of a cigar, if you smoke that same 6x60 in a Corona, that's why people tend to stay away from the Corona a little bit, is... In my humble opinion, is two reasons. One, A, it's a little bit stronger, And two, in the New England type of attitude is that I'm getting a bigger cigar for more for the money.
Mm. Yeah, it's more for the money.
Yeah.
I call it the rest area personally, but I'll tell you why later.
$2.95
Well, no, is it also true the larger ring gauge cigars and ones that are 60 ring throughout?
Yes.
That you can puff harder, you can smoke it faster, right, and it won't burn as hot.
This is true.
Of course.
Yeah, right. It's the flip side of a Lancero. Yeah.
Mm. But I think with the Gigante, all my comments have been in situations of what you would smoke. I find that people who only smoke Gigante 6x60s, and we know a few like Bill and whatnot at the lounge, that they just want something to put. They just want something to put in their mouth while they're doing something else.
Yeah, I agree with that.
They want something to smoke while they're concentrating more on like either fishing or
forgetting about their wife or something
to that effect. Right. And it's just something that they, they want to let me focus on this for a second. Oh, that there's a little bit of a note of this flavor.
Don't worry, they don't listen.
No, yeah. Mine does. it gives me like a TMJ. I just can't deal with it.
I agree. I find them uncomfortable.
Oh, yeah. What is it? But there's nothing wrong with them. I can't stress them.
Yeah, I think people trash them, but I think you
don't.
You're on the right path.
I mean, whatever fits your personality and your smoke and you're comfortable, go with it. Don't listen to that. I mean, by any reasons.
I will say this. I typically avoid them. Whole
like the plague.
But yeah, there are a couple that I
the Gran Cojono.
I think that we
that's what I was going to say.
Yeah.
The Gran Cojono. So the Gran Cojono is that good. I'm definitely not going to be disappointed.
We always come back
and enjoy it.
And we always come back to the Smoke In Padron Maduro 60 ring
by Padron.
I'm going to say that almost doesn't count. I'm sorry. It doesn't count. It's box pressed. It's box pressed.
It's illegal. No, it's illegal.
It's not box press.
No, it's not a box press.
It wasn't?
No.
It looks like a box press.
Mark Jr., I agree that it doesn't count because it's so hard to get because they don't make them anymore.
And you know, the whole thing is, Paul and I made the real bad mistake. 6x60, should we do the pie? We're really, really.
Yeah, we split a fiver. Now, everyone out there, let's take a vote. How many do you think I got? And how many do you think Stogie Santa got?
It's a 5-1. Where do you think a 5 was?
10-1.
So I got 2. Stogie Santa got 3.
And I got a little more after that.
Bastard.
I'll bring them out. But that, I agree with Mark.
I smoked one. It was like unbelievable.
If you close your eyes and if you didn't know it was a 660, you thought you smoked on a Corona. Wouldn't you agree?
So much flavor and just overpowering bold flavors. I'm just aging the other one in my humidor.
I think the big difference between someone who smokes a Gigante or a 6x60 or around that, because obviously there's no standard. That the ring gauge and the length changes slightly, but I think the big difference is that someone who does, like Mark Jr. here, who doesn't like usually a big ring gauge cigar, and someone who usually does, is Mark focuses more on the cigar and tries to get the flavors and the nuance of it, whereas someone who smokes a big ring gauge is just, they're smoking a cigar to more accentuate what they're doing at the moment. And regardless of that we're watching TV or on a balcony or fishing or something like that, it's more to just...
I think if you have a really big yard and it takes you 2 hours, because what do you think the smoking time is on... Well, we didn't talk about that on the Churchill. So what's the smoking time on the Churchill versus a 6x60?
Tim, what do you think? What's your call on this one, Tim?
I'm going to say it's about the same. I mean, I recommend a Churchill to people who are usually golfing.
Exactly. Because. Good, great call.
I mean,
I love Churchill for that.
That's what I call. That's what it is—a golfing cigar.
Churchill is the golfing cigar.
Oh, there's no doubt. Yeah, especially I would.
Better a double
handle. It's a lengthy smoking time, probably close to 2 hours.
I would say an hour 45 minutes to 2 hours. I mean, I'm not trying to
exactly. I
tone it down.
Would you say a 6x60 is a 2 hour smoke?
I would say it's about the same.
Except for the Gran Cojono. Yeah, notice about how quickly that burns.
It does burn fast. Some cigars burn quicker than others.
Gigante cigar to burn as quickly as that, but it's great.
It's light and airy and fluffy.
Asshole.
I couldn't help myself. 10,000 comedians out of a job. I think I'm one. But anyway, Tim, we did the 660. So we jumped right to 660. What do we got after the Churchill? You want to talk about?
Paul, you got the Bellicoso and Torpedo listed together.
Yeah, so I've got the Bellicoso and Torpedo listed together, and then Tobacconist University describes them as different.
Totally different.
So he says a torpedo is defined as being tapered at both the head and the foot.
Correct.
So the head being the part that goes in your mouth and the foot being the part that you light.
You shouldn't say it like that, the head in your mouth. I mean,
that's
good Lord. I mean, this is PG-13. Okay, go ahead.
I'm talking about the cigar, Stogie Santa.
Okay.
Whatever you put in your mouth. So when they say torpedo is being defined as tapered to both head and the foot, I think of that as a double torpedo.
No. See, the biggest difference between the torpedo and Bellicoso, Bellicoso has a closed head. A lot of people, they look at that almost like in a Corona type size.
I thought tapered at both ends would be more of a figurato.
No, figurato has a closed head, but generally with a Bellicoso, it's the size. It's 5.5 inches. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, Bellicoso says it's tapered at the head.
Usually closed at the head, too.
Yeah, it says Bellicoso is tapered at the head, which would imply that it's closed, and 5 to 5.5 inches long, although you'll often find them larger and smaller.
Right. Some people get really confused between a Bellicoso and a Perfecto. So there's a major difference.
So a torpedo to me, guys, stop me if I'm wrong, is a larger size. It's a 6x52.
Exactly. That's the key point, Tim, is the size. It's 6x52, and they look at a Bellicoso, totally different. Bellicoso, some people will actually look into it, if you look a little closer, into a more of like almost a Corona size. You see what I'm saying? That 4.5, 5-inch cigar. So even though it's a different cigar.
You know, the tapered cap, if you will.
So when I think Bellicoso, I think of a Cuban. I think of the Bolivar Bellicoso Finos because it has Bellicoso in the name. And that's a relatively shorter Bellicoso with a larger ring gauge. I mean, that's like a 52 ring gauge on it.
The tape in this in the middle.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
But Torpedo, I always thought of as a longer cigar.
More tapered.
A little bit of taper to it. So it starts off larger, maybe gets smaller. But I don't think of it as both the head and the foot being tapered.
Not a torpedo, absolutely.
But that's what it's saying. Tobacconist University says a torpedo is defined as being tapered at both the head and the foot.
Right.
That to me says that it's closed on both ends.
Well, it doesn't have to be closed, but I always think that would be a figurato. Like that makes.
That's what I'm saying.
What's the difference between a figurato, a perfecto, and a Salomon?
Right.
Who makes it?
How long do you have?
Right.
Yeah, exactly.
We can go on and on. We're trying to make this as general as possible.
Yeah.
Same thing. Some people say the Presidente, and I was reading different things, and I'm looking at, how can you say a Presidente is the same thing, what they were saying?
As a double Corona.
Mm. It's totally different. So again,
Presidente is longer.
Anything over 8 inches, you know what I mean?
So to move on to the double Corona. Mm-hmm. So Bellicoso Torpedo, we're kind of on the fence on the really what the difference is.
Right. So,
but a double Corona is defined to me by Tobacconist University, 7 to 8 inches long with a ring gauge greater than 49.
Right.
That's how they define it.
Exactly. And see, that's the big thing. People have to realize it's not, you can go tape it here, it's size.
But that would say that a 7x60 is a double Corona.
Right. So, again.
I think it's comparable to Churchill.
You're slicing
and dicing.
What it
boils down to is an epic journey is what a double Corona is.
And if you go back.
Hours.
And go back to what you said to me, what Dion said, the teaching machine. That's where you go back to whatever. What do you want to do? And that's where the Bellicoso, they're saying, what's the difference between that, a Bellicoso and a Torpedo? The biggest, of all the cigars I find that has the most defined is the Bellicoso. Do you see it? If you go on any different website, what you're talking about anywhere, the Bellicoso is 5.5. There's no five and three quarters, 5 and 5/8.
So Bellicoso is defined by the length.
Yeah.
And the fact that it's tapered on the head.
And right. So you don't find, like, for instance, you'll find a Robusto, 5x50, 5x52.
Yeah, yeah.
Or it can be 5.5. You know what I'm saying? Bellicoso has that one thing in common. It's the size.
Gotcha.
So anyway.
So smoking time on a double Corona, I'd say 2 to 2.5 hours.
All of 2 hours.
2 hours.
Minimum two hours. Right. Let's put it like that.
Instead of 2 hours.
Right.
Anyone care to, while we're on the size, that we don't talk about much on the show, what's your favorite double Coronas out there?
I would have to say the punch, a Cuban double Corona.
I got a tie, actually. And the Opus X.
Wow.
And
how can I forget that? Great and, call.
Fanboy.
The Diamond Crown Maximus double Corona with some age on it. I smoked one a couple months ago. It blew my mind. It absolutely blew my mind. I know Stogie Santa's not a big fan, and he's looking at me like I'm a jerk.
No. No, because no, what I'm looking at is that because your flavor profile is so elite, and I mean that in a great sense, because you go to Opus, and then you go to a Diamond Crown, I just it behooves me. You know what I'm saying? It's two different, but yeah, I mean, the Maximus, I just
that,
can't get it.
This double Corona that I had was 3 years old, and I'm telling you that
really?
Thing was awesome.
Wow.
Awesome.
I'll have to revisit that.
I smoked it in the car because I had a negative connotation in my mind towards it and wished that I hadn't wasted it on a cigar.
And
ride.
The biggest thing, the why you were negative was what?
Oh, it's stupid money.
It's stupid money.
Yeah,
that's what I'm saying. You're paying that kind of money. I'll go to the Opus Double Corona. Won't even do it. It's not even a comparison.
Ben wants to weigh in with the Double Corona. I think you probably smoke more Double Coronas than most of us.
Yeah, but I would say the one I smoke the least is my favorite. And once again, it's because of the money. When they're kicking, they're really good, which is the Cohiba Double Corona. I think that is a really great cigar.
Mm-hmm. You're talking Dominican Cohiba.
No, I'm talking about the Cuban Double Corona.
Cuban Double Corona Cohiba.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Very nice. Okay. For me, I had, for some reason, a Double Corona that sticks out in my mind, is I had a La Gloria Cubana. It's like it's called a Charlemagne.
Charlemagne.
But Charlemagne's essentially a double Corona.
Yeah.
I had one in a natural wrapper that had to have had some. It was like the last. I was at a shop, and there was like one lonely cigar sitting in the bottom of the box. And I kind of felt bad for it because like it seemed like no one wanted to smoke it. So I bought it, and it was absolutely fabulous. And I bought a lot of the Charlemagne's, which were not as fabulous. But that particular one, for whatever reason,
right? And that's kind of what I'm saying about that Diamond Crown is I've smoked other Diamond Crowns, and I thought they were good, not great. Certainly didn't justify the money, so I figured screw it. I was actually going to Philadelphia, and I had a 5.5 hour ride in front of me, so I figured it would knock out the first half of my ride. And I was genuinely disappointed that I had wasted that on a cigar.
In a car, yeah. Tim, do you have some larger sized cigars that you particularly enjoy? I know you don't often get a chance to smoke some of those larger sizes.
Well, I'll be honest with you. I'm not a fan of the Double Corona. I think it's maybe I got a little bit of a attention deficit disorder going on there. Is every Double Corona I've ever had has bored me by the time I've gotten to the last third. Maybe it's just bad luck on my part. But it's just something that long, nothing has had the flavor profile that's kept my attention for that.
Now, when Stogie Santa comes back, I want to ask him this too. The Padron 1926 number one Maduro, is that that to me would be considered a double Corona?
Is that a double Corona or a Presente?
Which one is Presente? Which part of the 1926 is that? Again?
The number one, the largest size.
Oh, yeah.
I would say it up.
That's number
those
two.
Those are epic. Those are epic.
He's saying
the number one. The number one would be considered a double Corona, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Now, there's one I have not had, so maybe that's the double Corona that I've been looking for.
I think so, Tim. And I know you're...
I love the 1926, so I could...
Yeah, and I know you're a big fan of that line, and you like Padron. So I would say, for you, Tim, my recommendation would be to do the 1926 number one. What's the size on that, Stogie? You know off the top of your head?
That's going to be... I was 7x54.
Really? Is it that thick? It's that big. Because his box press is deceiving.
It is. That's.
It is 6¾x54.
50. All right. There you go. I was off by a quarter. I'm sorry. But that's...
So according to DePaca's University, that would not qualify as double Corona. See, it has to be 7 inches.
It has to be right. Again, that's what I'm saying. Every...
I think it varies company by company.
Exactly. That's the biggest thing. Yeah. That's if anything could be taken on what we're saying today, or excuse me, tonight, is what we're defining size, but it's per company that's putting out. That's a great point, Ben. And like I said, that double Corona punch was I just I had
I like yeah I, you I gave me really, one from was it the 2006 one
yeah.
you gave
oh
there's I'm, more consistency in the Cuban double coronas right. than there are yeah, in the I American agree. Double coronas
but that because, number one Tim I have some at home I'll hook you up with those and they're nicely
they're
aged.
Delicious
yeah they're, yeah they, I think they were I don't I think it was 207 or 206. They were rated top five. I don't want to say.
It's interesting
one.
Now. Like if we had to go back, so we're talking about our favorite double Coronas. If we had to go back and say what's our favorite Corona, it'd be too hard to decide. Or our favorite Robusto.
I can't do it.
But in something that's a larger size, you find that you don't smoke them as often, and you right. can come up easily with a favorite. And I think right. the same thing goes for the next size on our list, which is a Lancero, which is roughly a 7x38 ring gauge.
And that's the key. That's a Tim. I mean, excuse me, Paul. That's a key. The 38 makes a big difference to the 40. It really.
I agree. The 38 is a big difference from the 40. And I'm not sure. And I think anything less than that is too
big,
too thin. Well, anything like a 36.
I'm saying even a 40, it makes a difference.
Yeah,
to me.
A 36 or a 34 or 35 is mm-hmm. really really skinny, in my opinion.
Like the Monte Carlos.
Yeah, the Monte Carlos are like that. Yep. I mean, those are good. Right, that's probably the exception to the rule, but.
Yep.
I've had some 32s that are good, but they lack the complexity. Right. Of such of the lottery.
And then we're going back, the thinner the cigar,
you're limited.
Liner filter.
I think with thinner cigars, some people, you know, sometimes we have a tendency to smoke them a little too fast.
Yeah, you're absolutely right.
That's as Ben was mentioning, great point. We go to a 660, we suck it like a vacuum, and that's okay. But
it's a little too hot.
Exactly. When you go to a Lancero, and even Tim, I don't know how well you feel like this. I want to not just Tim, everybody here. I even change my smoking habits on a Corona.
Without a doubt.
Yeah. In the Lancero for that matter.
Exactly. Lancero's a no-brainer, but even a Corona. I'm sorry. That's just the way it is.
So the characteristics that I had listed for Lancero is that they are, one, difficult to roll, is what I'm told.
Impossible.
Often does not pour smoke, does not emit as much smoke as some of the other sizes.
It just can't.
But delivers in the flavor department.
Right.
Obviously because the wrapper to filler ratio is much, much
greater. Let me say one thing about the Lancero. When they're on, they're on.
Agreed.
A blend that is on, load up on them.
Absolutely.
I think of recent one that I've had, the 100 Años.
Oh, absolutely. Hands down.
That thing is fantastic.
The top two that come to my list are... the 100 Años that Tim mentioned and the Paul Gamarian Reserva Exclusiva Gran Panatella.
Oh yeah,
that one too.
I'm gonna expound upon that. The El Triunfadores.
Those are good.
Now the El Triunfadores, what he's talking about.
The original releases, the brown label.
The brown label, the Connecticut Broad.
Graham Cracker?
Yeah. Oh, Graham Cracker.
Are we talking about Graham Cracker?
We're talking Graham Cracker.
If you go out and get an off-brand type of Lancero that you're not familiar with. You smoke that; it's got a tight draw. You're pissed off. I can understand that.
See,
you really got to pick your poison with the Lancero.
With the Lancero, that is the cigar I will bring to a wedding. I will bring to an event where I'm not sure if there's going to be a lot of cigar smokers for a couple of reasons. One, I find with the Lancero, the smoke that comes out of a Lancero is not as offensive as a smoke that comes out of a Gigante.
Who gives a shit?
Well, I'm talking that, and also this.
See, Ben cares about that kind of stuff. Stogie Santa does not.
I care about style.
Suck it.
So if I know that there might be someone who might be offended by someone smoking, I'll grab a Lancero, and I find that there's never an issue if I smoke a Lancero that.
I think for you, it detracts from your smoking experience if someone is offended.
I don't want to see someone looking at me. Like,
for Stogie Santa, it enhances his smoking experience if he's pissing someone else off.
Oh, exactly.
He pulls his pants down.
I don't give a shit.
He moons them, flips them off, blows smoke in their face.
I find that a Lancero is less offensive to people
agree,
that do not smoke.
But the whole thing is, it's just that you got to find the spot. I just love it for the fact of what it delivers. And if I'm delivering at a wedding or if I'm delivering with my friends, it's just...
Stogie Santa goes to the daycare in 6x60 and he's just blowing big.
I'm going to go out on the limb here, right? And I'm going to sound like a jerk, and I'm willing to do that. I like to hand a Lancero to someone and see what their reaction is.
Oh, yeah. They look at it because they think you're a fag.
Yes, you did.
I bought a box of La Aurora.
Why are you smoking años. A pencil?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. I bought a box of 100 Años Lanceros, and I gave them out to commemorate the birth of my daughter. And there's this guy that I really like, but I play cards with him. He's a 6x60 guy, right? Mm. And I hand it to him, and he goes, "Do you have anything thicker?"
Yeah, exactly. Well, he said, "Take a look at your shorts."
I got a sense of satisfaction out of telling him, just smoke the fucking thing. Yeah.
No, but on a more serious note, it's the size. It scares it because they don't, you know, it's like, how do I smoke this? They don't know.
And if you're going out on like a first date and you're the type that you want to smoke, I find exactly to the point that Mark just brought up, like, I find that the Lancero is less intrusive, less offensive.
Oh, there's no doubt about that.
You know, if you smoke and the other person doesn't,
it's a finesse cigar.
You know,
so you take your first dates to like the cigar lounge, Ben?
I'll go to restaurants.
Maybe not the first one, but a second one, yeah.
I'll definitely go to restaurants where if you're eating out in the lounge, they allow smoking. So if you go to Federal Hill in Providence or Cove in the jewelry district, like, they allow smoking, and you know, I think that's great.
You smoked a White Owl. Okay.
Yeah, I'll smoke a White Owl in front. This is a fine cigar, baby. This is the best.
We're losing track here. But again, back to Lancero, finesse cigar. Okay, moment of silence here.
15 seconds of silence.
I don't know how to transition.
The Lonsdale?
I don't know how to transition from smoking on dates and White Owl to...
I'm still amazed that Ben has dates. So.
Wow.
I will never say
that. Don't say much.
Again.
I'm joking. No, I'm just saying Ben, White Owl, the big White Owl. Awesome. You know, Black Owl, White Owl, whatever. So.
Check your brakes next time you drive.
Tim, do you have anything more on sizes, Tim?
No, I was going to bring up the Lonsdale, but let's not go there, man. I don't want to confuse people.
Hold on. So what is a Lonsdale? Because I'm kind of confused on this too.
Slightly larger than the Lancero.
A little thicker than the Lancero.
So what, like a 39 to a 42?
Yeah, I would say so.
38 to 42.
Again, when they're on, they're on. One that comes to mind is the La Riqueza, number one.
Oh,
very good.
Great call.
Great Lonsdale, very underrated. But, you know, just wanted to mention it.
I could add one, actually, as well. The Flor de Rafael Gonzalez, it's a budget Cuban cigar. They make a Lonsdale size, and it's fantastic. Mm. It really is.
Yeah, a Lonsdale, I think, is probably more misconstrued. It's underrated. Yeah, me too. Stogie Santa's having a hard time with those words. But anyway, you talk about a Lancero. Some people don't even know what a Lonsdale is, seriously, on a serious note.
So, Stogie Santa, what's the most popular size sold in the store?
6x60, hands down, I would say.
Really?
Oh, there's not even a... It's amazing. 6x60s, I would say...
And what kind of 6x60s are people buying? Just like
I would say it's more... Gran Habano, the 7,000 Maduro...
7,000 in the Padron?
Padron. The LFDs.
LFDs do LFD, to be a 60. Used, yeah.
Because LFD, I give them a lot of credit. I'm not any sponsor of anything. LFD, they're a good, I mean, for $8 smoke, how can you go wrong?
So it's $8 for an LFD?
$8.25 for LFD, 6x60, it was really good. But the Gran Habano.
What is that, like a thousand or a hundred or 300 or 400, 500?
No, that's the regular double a hero.
Okay.
And then you go into the Czar, which is a 6x66. So it's over an inch wide. So again, I can go on and on. The Super Gordo by Don Pepin, another fabulous smoke. People love large ring cigars. It just now, again, I'm talking is Northeast.
Is that part of the motivation for EPC to come out with the inch? Right.
Yep. Exactly. And then, from what I understand, the JFR, the 7x70.
JFR.
Oh, yeah.
What's
about JFR? The Digger?
Same thing. This is the digger. How can you go wrong with that?
And so, yeah, what's the price on the Dicker?
Believe it or not, $8.99.
Oh my God, yeah, that's exactly. A gigantic smoke.
Yeah, that's
a lot of tobacco for that money.
Did you try that, Tim?
No, I haven't tried it. I was gifted that.
I thought it was. It's not as strong as your typical LFD.
Right, because you're going. Look at the size of it. Yeah,
but I think it brings down to the point that the majority of cigar smokers, like probably the type that doesn't listen to Stogie Geeks, but like your typical cigar smoker is smoking a cigar because he just wants something to do to accentuate what he's doing at the time present. And he wants a big ringing cigar that lasts a long time. He's not really focusing on the flavors, but he just wants something nice and
very
tasty to have in his mouth, essentially. Mm-hmm. Oral fixation from the time of birth.
Oh, boy. I think we ought to wrap it up on that note.
The nipple.
Jesus, God. Wow. Okay.
All righty.
Yeah, okay.
So that rounds out our introduction to cigar sizes. Believe it or not, there are so many sizes we haven't talked about yet.
We're gonna, and
the next thing I want to do is I want to get into the ones we didn't talk about and the ones that are somewhat specific to manufacturers, like the 11-18 size, yes, like the Hemingway sizes,
8-9-8,
the 8-9-8, the whole.
Oh,
there's a
so
whole world.
We haven't touched the perfectos at all.
Tim, exactly. That's a great point.
And I think another one too to just throw out there is a short Robusto, Petit Corona. So there's like smaller.
It goes on. I mean, the list goes on.
Focuses and on the length, right?
I don't know if it was Ben, Tim, Mark. I don't remember. But going back to the manufacturer of what they determine what it is, not so much the guidelines of sizes.
It's true. You
can go to Tobacco University. You can go to anybody. What they may call a Corona to a. To a belly.
I really think it originates with family too, because a lot of the companies are family owned companies, and I think it's just something that traditional wise, that's what their preference was exactly.
Mm. One last note I would say is that there's a more of a steadfast adherence to the sizes in Cuban cigars than in the American market.
Oh yeah, absolutely. That's well dealt.
So
and what we're saying our variances or tolerances, whatever you want to call it. It's so much tighter in the Cuban market than it is in the American market.
I agree. There's no wholeheartedly. Mm-hmm. You don't see a Cuban Robusto that's not what it's
5x50. Right. Yeah, 5x50, and that's it. It's not 52 anyway.
Well, guys, thanks for participating in the show. And, of course, thanks, everyone, for listening. And we will see everyone on the next edition of the Stogie Geek Show.
Thank you very much.